A 19-year-old Guernsey man has been found guilty of murdering 21-year-old James Christopher Dean in September last year. Craig Roger has been sentenced to life in prison.
Chief Inspector Peter Dowding of Guernsey Police, who led the investigation, said it was a tragic incident.
Well, the tragic events of September 2006 has changed forever the lives of two local families. However, the parents of James Christopher Dean will never see their son again, and his sisters will never see their brother. I hope that the judgment given today in the court will somehow bring this last 18 months to some finalisation, and the family can hopefully move on.
Closing speeches are being heard in the trial of a Guernsey teenager accused of murder. 19-year-old Craig Roger denies killing James Christopher Dean in St.Peterport last September.
We'll never be able to celebrate another birthday, Christmas, or any other anniversary with James. And every time any of these celebrations come around, we sorely miss him. Because he was always the life and soul of the party. And no matter what has been said about James, we know what he was really like. Loving to his family and friends and anybody who got to know him.
France at the time, and we'd been out that evening with our friends, and we'd been to a restaurant, and we got back from the restaurant, the friends that we were staying with there, the parents were staying there as well, and when we got back, we had our friends, Karen and Kevin. Karen had a message from her mother and father saying that. Could she phone their daughter, and which they did, and that's when we first got an inkling that something was wrong.
And who made that? Did she call them?
So she called them, and she said, "We think there's that James may have been involved in a, some kind of incident." But that's as much
stabbed.
As we thought.
We got told he'd been stabbed, and that. He was all right, but that he'd go get ready to take him down to theatre.
And this is all still whilst you're away, this is
yeah.
The thing.
Yeah. So I phoned the hospital, and that's something I'll never forget. And that's when they told me that he died. And I just couldn't take the rest of the call.
No, our friend Ken took the rest of the call because we couldn't talk to the doctor. So, and then we phoned, after we sort of composed ourselves a bit, we phoned Lindsay.
Dad had phoned me because I kept saying to the nurses, I kept saying, please tell me it's not true. And she said, I'm so sorry. And I said, please, and then Dad phoned me and then said to me, please, Lindsay, tell me it's not true. And I said, I can't, Dad, I'm so sorry. I can't tell you it's not true.
You then had to get yourselves back. How quickly were you able to get back?
That was awful that night because we were trying to get back because we just wanted to be back with our girls and with the grandchildren and everybody, just be back in the Highlands. And the airport would open over here, but the French airport and wouldn't open,
would
they?
No.
So
that was the longest night of my life, I think. Just waiting for morning to come so that we could catch the flight. And we just, all the things that were going through our head. It's unbelievable.
We didn't sleep. We were just trying all the time. I mean, family over here, people were trying it over here to, even talking about getting boats out to bring us over, but we just...
People were willing to fly.
Fly on those.
People that we knew who had planes were willing to fly out, but the French airport at Dinard just wouldn't open, so it would have been pointless.
Yeah. And when you did get back, how did the, you know, the emergency services go? Or were the police there to meet you? Did they help you?
Yeah, Andy Pumford, our police
liaison officer. Yeah, he was waiting for us when we got there, and introduced us and took us to a car, and then drove us down to Lindsay's, where everybody was waiting for us.
We were just hoping, weren't we, that it hadn't happened or anything. But as soon as we walked in, we just knew him. Yeah, well, we knew anyway, but you know, you're just sort of like thinking, no, it's not true. But as soon as we walked into Lindsay's house and saw everybody there, it was just, you know, Lindsay and Kenny and children, we just knew then that it's true.
And obviously those next few days, the support and everything around you and all the people, you said you got loads of cards, and it must have been, no one can even imagine what that feels like.
Well, it became like a florist in there, didn't it? There's the amount of flowers that were being sent in. And the cards that came through with fantastic messages.
We had cards from people we didn't know, or didn't really know us, but, you know, they just felt they had to write to us. And
I think it shocked the island, didn't it? So it was not just people that were close to us, it was people that, who were in the island, who were part of the community.
And what was it, at what point did you actually find out, you know, exactly what had happened? You knew, obviously, you're getting over the shock of what's been said to you, but at what point did you kind of stop and did the police explain it to you, or how did that work?
Yeah, they did. I mean, they used to come, we stayed at Lindsay's, Kelly and... We all stayed because we felt that we wanted to be together, and we didn't want to, I couldn't come back to the house anyway, I thought I just can't come back here. And the police used to come, Randy used to come quite often, and he'd let us know what was going on. He came every day at first, didn't he? It was every day,
yeah.
And then he'd let us know. I mean, obviously those things they couldn't tell us because, you know, if we told somebody else, or it might have, you know,
affected the court. The outcome of the court.
It'd be quite frustrating for you then, obviously. You just want to know what happened, or why, or how, and you've got all these questions.
Yeah, I mean, we wanted to know. We wanted told, and then, you know, there was also like when they had to do a post-mortem, obviously, on James, and then we got told that his advocates wanted a post-mortem. And then that was really upsetting, but you know, they said that they could have, if they wanted to, they could have asked the three or four. And then one way we were quite lucky that they only asked for one, because there's nothing else that, you know, different to what there was at found.
And did you know who it was that had, did they tell you the name of the person, or did they not, like, did they keep that until?
I think we'd already heard, hadn't we?
Yeah, we had heard. We did know, actually, and it was his picture actually was in the paper. The next day, wasn't it? There was a little picture of him.
It said that he'd been arrested, yeah.
Before that, did you know him, or were you his family, or anything?
We've never met him or anything.
But how long did you have to wait until you could have James's funeral?
Well, it was about another...
It was the 28th of September, I think.
That's about 3 weeks, wasn't it? Three or four weeks.
Yeah.
So, it's quite a while afterwards.
Mm-hmm. I mean, at first we couldn't even go and see him, could we, either?
No.
The first weeks, we wanted to go and see him, but...
Because of the fact that, you know, they weren't allowed to let anybody tamper with the body or touch the body or anything like that. You know, so obviously because it was a murder inquiry, we couldn't go in and see him. support, and the feedback we got from the police was very, very good, and even from the detective that was running the case.
Yeah, he came to see us as well, didn't he?
He did come to see us and explain how the case was going as much as he could without, obviously doing anything that would damage the case.
I was still at home because I had Leo, and I had to wait for somebody to come and look after him and then take me up to the hospital. So I didn't know at this point what was going on, and Lindsay didn't want to call me because she wanted me to get to the hospital. But it took forever for me to get there, and I was just pacing around the house, not knowing what was going on, thinking that because I hadn't heard anything, it was probably good news. So when I got to the hospital, I went straight to the desk and I said, I'm here to see my brother James. And one of the doctors, Dr. Chandler, he started taking me towards a room, and I was like, please, can you tell me what's going on? Why are you taking me here? All I want to do is go and see James. And we got to where the door was, and I said, please just tell me, can you tell me, has he died? And he said, I'm sorry. And I entered the room at that point and just fell into Lindsay's arms. And it was really hard from that minute onwards. It was just like I was in a dream.
I've been friends with Dino since about 4 or 5 years old, when we started at Favourite School. We were always playing at each other's houses, and I would always be around his, he would be at mine. We both went to St. Peter at school, and we were always the same again, good friends, and always looked out for each other. One thing I found with Dino is he was very loyal to his friends. He was loyal in more ways than you can imagine. If you needed somebody to talk to, or shoulder to cry on, he was always the guy that you'd go to. After the night that it happened, the night we just stayed together. We spent a lot of time up Lindsay's house with Dino's parents and family, and I remember the amount of cards and flowers and that were there. It was overwhelming, really. There was hundreds of cards, and it was from sometimes people that didn't really know James or the family. They were just members of the community that, came together and just, were concerned and just wanted to share their feelings and their support, which was really nice. I feel that was probably what helped a lot of the grieving process, is just everybody was pulled together and just showed their concern and their love, The words can't really describe how this has changed my life, and not for the best. The only thing that's happened is it's just torn. I've watched my friends just fall apart, and it's ruined so many people's lives. I feel that I'm making a really good fresh start at the moment, but it's up and down. Some days you're fine, other days you just don't want to be around anybody, you just want to be on your own. Or there's some days you have to be around people, you need people to comfort you. And there's friends of mine that it's just happened to them, and you can just see we're not who we were. It changed who we were, but we didn't want to change who we were. We were having the times of our lives, and just like that, it was taken from us. At 21 years old, you don't expect to be attending your best friend's funeral. You don't expect to be, seeing a counsellor about problems that you just shouldn't be talking about. It shouldn't have happened. That one small act of violence has caused an absolute unbelievable amount of pain, suffering, for absolutely no reason. My advice to anybody is the bigger man is the man that walks away. And if you can do that, then you've got it made. Just walk away.
I was on duty, or I came on duty just after the incident in town. And in my role as a family liaison officer, it soon became clear that it had gone. A deceased person was on our hands, and I was involved and allotted to that task. So I went from the police station up to the hospital where James had been taken. We had good response from the public. When it became widely known, the press were involved. We had a great help from members of the public, shopkeepers, other officers were involved in gathering CCTV, which was very useful in the subsequent trial. We were able to capture a lot of the images that happened in the High Street that night. And also other members of the public came forward, gave statements, witness statements, which ultimately helped in the trial. That was a very confused situation when I got to the hospital. James was quite a friendly guy. He had a lot of friends, and it didn't take long for everybody to hear what had happened. Besides family, James's sisters and brother-in-law being at the hospital, there were a lot of friends there. And there was a lot of upset, tears, panic. It was horrendous scene, really.
Okay, and so being a family liaison officer, James's parents weren't here at the time.
That's correct,
Did you deal with them, obviously, whilst they were away, or how did that work?
I initially made contact with Lindsay and Kelly at the scene, at the hospital. From them I learned that Mum and Dad were away in France. And so after that evening, we had to make arrangements to get Mum and Dad, Chris and Martine, back. And so I was partially involved in arranging flights. We managed to get a private charter, and we got them back quickly for the next day.
As a family liaison officer, you must have to be, a particular type of person. Do you have to have any specific kind of training, or?
Yes, I did some training here when I first came, although in my role as a traffic officer when I was in the UK, because I've done most of my service in the UK, as a traffic officer there, if you went to a fatal accident, you took on the role as family liaison officer. So I was involved with families prior to my coming to Guernsey, but I did get some extra training when I came to Guernsey to assist me in the role.
As you say, news kind of spreads fast over here. It's a small place, and there was a lot of emotion. How do you, as an individual, deal with that?
You can't say it doesn't affect you, because it does. I'm a father of three boys of my own, all teenagers at that time, but grown up a bit more now. But it does affect you, because you put yourself in the position of Chris and Martine, and I'm a father. I've got three boys, and you get emotionally involved. You cannot help it. But I think it helps me to be emotionally involved, because I can then deal. I know what they're feeling. I can help them.
Were you involved from start to finish then? How long were you sort of a family liaison to the family?
I was involved with the family right until the end of the trial. So from the beginning, I made regular contact, especially in the initial days. I was with them perhaps every day. As time went on, that became less and less, but I was involved with them all the time, right through to the trial, and I stayed with them until the
third. Did you go to court then? When
I went with I went with the family to every court appearance.
What is that like, when you're there with the family waiting? I mean, that must be really a difficult time, to be able to try and support people when they're, hoping that the right outcome.
Yes, it is. But I think Chris and Martine were well aware that they had the backing of everybody concerned. It's a very emotional time for them, and I have to say that Chris in particular was so brave because there was CCTV to be viewed, and he was able to steel himself and watch what happened. So his bravery was something to be, you know, admired. I don't know how I would be able to cope with that if it had been my son, but certainly the members of the family stuck together and they all helped each other.
Yeah. And what would you say to anyone, you know, maybe not other police officers, but personally, how do you feel towards people that carry knives, you know, they say they need it for protection or as a weapon?
What can you say about that? Until you see the hurt that people go through when they lose somebody through knife crime or any crime, you can't understand the pain that I've seen people, James's family have gone through in these past few years. They're just now trying to build a life again, but it will never be the same. And anybody who carries a knife for protection or to look big really need to talk to these people so they can tell them how they felt after an incident like this destroyed their lives forever.
How could anybody do something like that? It's just, I can't describe the feeling that I feel towards him. It's a mixture of all different emotions.
And obviously having children of your own, he was your brother, but knowing how your mum and dad were gonna feel, you start to sort of imagine if that was your child.
Definitely. Yeah. Couldn't think of anything worse than losing a child.
Do you find that you're more protective of your children now? Like, obviously, you go to the end of the earth for your kids, but do you think that it's made you, is Lydia sort of like, I'm fine, Mum, and you're like, are you sure? Like, even more now, so, since then.
Yeah, she's out and something. I'm always on the phone to her, making sure she's okay, and if she doesn't answer, I start panicking, and it's just, I just remember the night with James, I was trying to phone his mobile all the way to the hospital while James and Hem was driving up, and he wasn't answering, and I was going, he would answer, because he always answered his phone. I was like, he would answer, and now if Lydia doesn't answer, I stop panicking.
How is it for you, Lydia, having a mum? She just cares, doesn't she?
Yeah, I know how much she worries, so I try to make sure she does phone that I do answer, because I know if not, she'll just be worrying all night.
And what about, obviously, being sort of 13, 14 years old, you were at school at the time, and James, a lot of people knew James, and it was something that everybody heard about. How was it for you? It must have been really difficult having, lots of friends, lots of people sort of talking about it, and I know what schools can be like, rumours and people don't know the truth, and must have been really difficult for you.
Yeah, it was really hard. I didn't want to go back to school. And then when I did go back, it was more hard because everyone looked at you differently or treated you differently. It was just like, I don't know, acted really weird, and you kind of just wanted it to be the same, so.
He has obviously been sentenced and he's still waiting in the UK for his next sentence. Would you want to see him? Would you have anything that you'd want to say to him? Or?
I don't think I would like to see him.
No.
I've got nothing to say to him, really.
I don't think there's anything that he can say to make anything better. There's nothing he can say.
And obviously living in Guernsey and it being such a small place, his family do live here, and there is the potential that he's going to come back and live here. Would you want to try and stop him from doing that? Would you rather he wasn't here?
Definitely rather he wasn't in the island.
I wouldn't like to see him walking down the high street. Or, I just don't think I would.
Not knowing he's living his life. And James can't.
I think it's worth realising that this wasn't just me, it wasn't just a nurse in the accident and emergency. This was a team. There was myself, there were three other doctors. There was a team, at times up to 10 nurses. We pulled most of the intensive care nurses down to help as well. And this kind of event has really wide-reaching ramifications. All members of the team were very deeply affected by this and shocked. All members of the team were very upset. And in this sort of situation, what we try to do is bring all the team together again immediately afterwards to talk about it. And then at a later date, several weeks down the line, to bring the team together to talk about it. And here we are now, 5 years down the line, and I don't need the notes to know exactly what happened that night. I can remember every single thing that happened that night. This kind of event is absolutely tragic. It's terrible for the family, awful for James, clearly. I would imagine that his assailant is also regretting his actions. And I should imagine he's fairly shocked by what happened. And the team involved, I don't think we'll ever forget it. And I think we do still talk about it in hospital 5 years later, about that night. And you always ask yourself, well, if we'd have had 5 minutes more, if we'd have been there 5 minutes earlier, if it hadn't have been such a tight tamponade, could we have got things going? Could we have saved his life? And these things always prey on you, and they always will.
I try and think of all the memories. And for me personally, I've tried a way of coping is just to think that he's gone away. And that helps me through.
I don't think it gets any easier. I just think you learn to deal with it on a daily basis, but it doesn't get any easier.
No, definitely not.
The pain's there every day. You wake up, I wake up every day and I think about James first thing, and I go to bed and I think about him. It never goes away.
Just got a short statement to make on behalf of the family. The night of the 9th of September 2006 will be a night our family will never forget. Nobody can quite understand what it's like to lose a child, brother, grandson, nephew, uncle, cousin or good friend unless it's happened to them, especially when it need never have happened. The verdict today will not bring our James back, but it may go some way to preventing some other family from going through what this family has gone through for the last 10 months and will continue to go through for the rest of our lives. We would like to thank the police and the Crown Prosecution for all their very hard work. And would also like to thank family and friends, members of the general public for their continued support. We will never be able to celebrate another birthday, Christmas, or any other anniversary with James. And every time any of these celebrations come around, we sorely miss him. Because he was always the life and soul of the party. And no matter what anybody, what has been said about James, we know what he was really like. Loving to his family and friends, and anybody who got to know him. I can only say to the public, please, do not take weapons. The chance that you will use one is quite, there's a very good chance and you could ruin the lives of many, many people. The sooner the knife culture is eliminated from our society, the better. Thank you very much.
Dino was such a unique person. He was a very caring and loving person. He put his friends and his family before himself. His aim in the day would be to make you happy, and you know, even if times were bad and you needed to chat to somebody, he'd be the one you'd go to. And we all do have problems, and he would be the one that would either give you the advice that you need, even just listen, or if you needed a laugh, then he'd be the one that would make you laugh. I can't explain how much I miss him, because words can't describe that. But I mean, if he was here today, I mean, the fun that we'd still be having, the great times, the more memories that we'd have. It's just so sad that we've lost one of the best lads I've ever known.
I just wrote her messages now, which we do every year on his birthday and then his anniversary. And we'll go outside and have a toast to Dino and send off the balloons.
Serve God, love me, and sorry.
Lovely to see you all, obviously under not great circumstances, but you know, 4 years have gone down the road, and you know, it only seems like yesterday really in many ways, but we just want to say thank you again, and to everybody that's helped in one of the losers gone tight. and raise your glasses and cheeky vimto to James.
James!
Okay, let's go!
The man you were made to be. There is a design and alignment to cry of my heart to see.
Up to now, how are you coping with it? Do you still think about it all the time?
Oh my god, there's no day that goes by
That night?
Well, not just that night, just that night, dealing with losing a friend.
That night, I block it out. I was keeping blocking it out.
Yeah, same.
To be honest with you, it's going to live with us for the rest of our lives.
Take it too great.
You learn to deal with it, obviously, day by day. But
it's just afterwards, though. I mean, like, all the emotions the boys that went through. I mean, I sat there and I saw it. I mean, for them to be there, for them to see what they saw, to witness what they did, to feel so helpless that they hadn't have done something different, they hadn't have, you know, walked forward and pulled him away, or something hadn't have changed for them to, you know, just one little thing could have changed all of that.
To see all of them
go through so much hurt, they blame themselves.
I think for a long, long time, yeah, we all blamed ourselves. I know it's not, but it's just the way of thinking at the time. It's just having that in your, I don't know, in your conscience.
Seeing that.
Just knowing that.
You could have done one tiny little thing and it would have changed it.
Even today I still think, do you know what I mean? Especially like anniversaries, birthdays, you know.
Christmas.
You know, it's always like, I always still think like, what have we done this? Or what if we didn't go out at night? Or
What if?
That's the thing that's the hardest. That's the thing that's the hardest, though. I mean, you know, you've had Ella.
Yeah, that's
James will never see Ella. You know, Ella will never know James. You know, Lindsay's still a baby. All of these. Today, you saw all of those. 4 years ago, when we had the first anniversary, it was all of us holding those balloons, letting those balloons go. Today, it was all of our children letting those balloons go. And that's what hurts so much, is that he'll never meet, our children will never know him, our children will never see his smile, they'll never know what character he is, they'll never know how hysterically funny, how he has you in stitches, when you can be in the baddest mood ever and you can just say one thing and it just changes everyone's mood.
Yeah, who needs antidepressants when you've got
dinner? Exactly.
So I say, like, every day is supposed to get easier, but it doesn't, because it's every day that he's missed.
Yes, it seems to get harder at times.
Yeah, it never gets easier. You know, it's like saying, like, with Ella and that's, do you know what I mean? Like, hands down, he would have been the godfather to her. And, like, when I get married and things, he's the best man as well. And, you know, and you just think of things like that, every, like,
The stuff that he missed.
Oh, just one stupid thing and it's taken away so much.
We've all been through a lot of pain and hurt a bit. We still do at times, especially on days like this, but he's got to remember the good memories as well. And he would have wanted it that way as well, just for us to remember the good times.
And I think at the time, the worst thing was for us was to just be stood there on the sidelines, almost seeing what his family had been through, seeing what it did to that family, how something like this affects a family like them that are so close, so loving, such amazing people, and
you just feel helpless.
You just wish you could do something to change and take some of their pain away.
It could have happened to anyone. It's not just people pointing the finger at James. Or, you know, it could have happened to anyone at the end of the day.
One place, one time.
I mean, as soon as you put that knife in your pocket,
you're putting a lot more lives than yours on the hurt, pain, because as soon as you've used that knife, you're not just taking a life, you're ruining everyone's family life.
You're ruining your own family's life.
You're destroying life, yeah. You're ruining your own family's life by carrying the knife and using it, and you're ruining the victim's family's life. So you're not just, when you put that knife in your pocket, there's a lot more than one life at risk. There's family lives.
Because you're taking like a generation.
Happy families ruined.
Only that people that use knives, they don't realise the actual damage that it can do.
No.
It just takes.
I mean, like David said, that punchy wound was tiny, absolutely tiny. The damage that it caused was fatal.
I'm sorry. At the end of the day, I don't.
Fatal.
For the guy that died, I don't. I've got no remorse for him or no sympathy because
he knew what he was doing.
He knew what he was doing.
Tell me why, tell me why. There are
are so many unanswered questions. Tell me why you were where you were that night. Tell me why I no longer feel the sun and rain on my face. Tell me why. Tell me why. Tell me why. Tell me why. Tell me.